Thanks very much, Kate. I'm going to hand over now to Fiona Read. Fiona is from the Whale and Dolphin Conservation, who have been supportive of our work. So thank you very much, Fiona.
Where are you finished? Oh, sorry, I don't think it's free.
It's just warming up.
So I'm basically just going to give a brief overview on whale and dolphin conservation's views on the proposed ship-to-ship whale transfer. And I think the main... So from our point of view, because we want to base our opposition on sort of like the status to try and that the best way we think is to oppose to it based on the Habitats Directive. So whether there's Brexit or no Brexit, the UK has the European Habitats Directive, and on that you've got the conservation objectives. So under this legislation, they have to have the long-term viability of protected species populations in order to maintain favourable conservation status. And you need to have special areas of conservation for Annex II species. And Annex II species visitations cover the bottlenose dolphin and the harbour porpoise. You need to have the maintenance of the natural range of the animals and also of the habitat. So the background of the area. So, based on Habitats Directive, we know we've got special area of conservation for the bottlenose dolphin in the Moray Firth, and it's based on a population estimate of around 192 animals. And at the moment, the population has been stated as stable. On a European level, it's one of the most important populations of bottlenose dolphins, and also it's locally very important. And then, so just on the pink bit is just to highlight, based on the data from Aberdeen University, which is from an SNH report, you can see the area in pink, which is around the suitors, is the area where the animals are most likely to be seen, and it's a critical habitat. And this is also, as was mentioned previously, the area that's proposed for the ship-to-ship transfer. So, as was mentioned previously, there's many potential threats to the dolphins and other visitations in the area. You've got changes in the prey abundance, there's direct injury from collision from vessels, you've got the potential for habitat loss, disturbance from increased vessels, and there's also a lot of disturbance potentially from wind farms and other aspects. You've got pollution of the animals. We know in this area, the bottlenose dolphins are highly polluted, and you've also got the potential of disease, natural disease, but you've also got potential diseases from the ballast water. But also the area is not only important for the bottlenose dolphins, you've got many other cetacean species, including the common dolphins, minke whales, you get the orca, harbour seals, grey seals, and also many bird populations. So our main concerns for the ship-to-ship oil transfer was that the baseline data was out of date and it was inadequate. They referred to in their documents the candidate SAC, although this SAC in the Moray Firth was estimated for bottlenose dolphins in 2005. So they're already using data which is 11 years out of date. There will be a significant increase in vessel traffic, and we know that this will have an impact on the dolphins most likely and other cetaceans. And then you've also got like just the pure size of the vessels. I think that some of the vessels will be up to 250 metres. So then you'll have a 500 metre exclusion zone around each vessel. And when you talk about the vessels, it's you've got the mothership and then the daughter ship, but then you've probably also got various tugs. And if you've got 500 metres around each of these vessels, you're actually excluding a large part of the area, which will also impact on the special area of conservation monitoring conducted by the University of Aberdeen. At the moment, it's been, when they talk about the oil spills, it's just assumed it will be one very large oil spill, but actually small continuous leaks will be just as significant for the animals. We know from the deep water horizon that there's severe health impacts on the animals. The animals are in a poor state of body condition, they've got lung disease, they've had adrenal problems, and they're not reproducing to the same level they were previously before the oil spill. And there's also evidence for the impacts on the health and reproduction of cetaceans in the UK. So we had a paper published last year on the harbour porpoise, and we showed that the harbour porpoises look like are having reproductive issues already down to contamination. And one problem was that this document that they submitted didn't look at the cumulative impacts at all. We know in the Moray Firth there's already a lot of activity, and this is just an extra impact on the animals. So, an overview. I think one of the main things was that the lack of stakeholder engagement was inadequate. So on the policy work, I work very closely with a lot of the renewables companies and the oil and gas for the decommissioning and that. And this proposal just basically appeared. None of us really knew where from. And we found out about it because I think someone from RSPB had heard about it, emailed us and said, "Have you heard about this?" And we all just kind of went, "No." And it's not fair how they do it because other industries aren't allowed to get away with that. It's very likely to have a serious impact on the animals in the area. And any impacts on the integrity of a special area of conservation are against the Habitats Directive. And I think that's one really strong point to oppose of this. And it's probably one of the main points is because you've got the Habitats Directive, you've got this special area of conservation for the bottlenose dolphins, and this will have an impact on the integrity. An appropriate assessment needs to be conducted. They did an HRA, it was inadequate. It was completely inadequate compared to what a renewables company would have to do, and that's not fair. Alternative sites and oil spill contingency plan cumulative impact assessment are required, and these haven't been done, and they haven't been done to any level that they should be required under the EU legislation. And overall, the best way to mitigate against these potential impacts is to not approve the proposal. So thank you, and any questions?